Today's episode of The Real Deal with Damian Adams is brought to you by The 3-Point Conversion. Now, The 3-Point Conversion is a sports media company where fans' opinions matter. We are all fans at heart. We just happen to be really knowledgeable fans that will bring you everything in sports, from boxing to football to basketball to soccer, NASCAR, WNBA, everything under the sports sun, The 3-Point Conversion brings you. It's because we care about the fans. So make sure you follow The 3-Point Conversion on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, and get what you need. Thank you for listening to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. This is real sports talk for the real sports fan, and I definitely appreciate all you real sports fans who are listening right now. And I'm back. It's been a little bit. You know, this time of the year gets a little slow. And I took a little break, but I'm glad to be back, you know, for the millions and millions of the Real Deals fans. You know, one day. Right now, it's probably dozens and dozens. But right, one day, it's going to be millions and millions. I'm very excited about today's episode. We got a lot to get into. We're going to get into Carmelo Anthony joining the Rockets finally. Bruce Bowen not getting renewed with the Clippers because of his comments about Kawhi Leonard. But first, we'll talk a little golf. That's right. Damian Adams is going to talk a little golf. And I know the people who have been listening to me for a while are probably like, we've never heard you talk about golf. You probably don't know anything about golf. You are correct. But because of that, I went out and got one of my friends, one of my closest friends in this industry, my main man, TK Goldsmith. He's host of a podcast called I Need A Mulligan. And he knows his golf, knows his MMA, knows his sports. So I had to get him on to discuss golf, Tiger Woods, of course. How you doing today, TK?
I'm doing great, man. Thanks for having me on. That was a heck of an intro, dude.
Thanks, appreciate it. I'm glad to have you on, man. It's been way too long. You know, some people may remember last time we were on here together, but it's been quite a while. So just for the people who, you know, may have missed that episode or just haven't heard your voice in a while, can you please tell them about the show I Need a Mulligan and what they can expect if they tune into that show, which you can subscribe to on iTunes?
Yeah, no problem, man. You hit the nail on the head there at the beginning of the show. It's been a, you know, it's a tough part of the season to get consistent, but yeah, I've been doing the show again here over the last few months. Basically, if you're going to listen to it, I talk sports, I drink booze, do second chances. I mean, that's kind of the whole premise behind the show. The sports that we talk about, usually the ones that I really, really love to talk about, is football, basketball, golf. MMA has been, I'm passionate about MMA, but just hasn't had the same feel over the last maybe year or so. So that one's kind of been, you know, hit or miss, but definitely football, basketball, golf, and then drink booze. Like right now I'm drinking a single malt scotch from, I think, Speyside. It's called Glenmorangie Speyside Scotch. It's like a port cask finish, really good scotch. It's relatively inexpensive. I think last time I was on, we talked about scotch on a budget or baller on a budget. This is kind of the same type of thing. It's a really good scotch, but it's inexpensive. And then at the end of every show, we talk about second chances, do-overs. Sometimes it's funny, sometimes it's serious, just kind of depends on the topic. And then I will say that I do like to drop my F-bombs, so little ears, beware. If you have some little ones around, I like to say that, you know, F-bombs will be dropping from anywhere. It's kind of like my three-point game, you know, in basketball. You just don't know when I'm going to be dropping a three. I like to say that, you know, I'm the Steph Curry of F-bombs in the podcast world. You know how it is.
Okay, no, I like that. It means that, you know, you land in 45% of your F-bombs. You know, that's a good percentage right there. I like that.
I need a lot of mulligans, but when it comes to dropping F-bombs, I don't really need a second chance.
Definitely. It's just something that you have perfected. And I'm a big fan of the show. I definitely recommend it for you guys. And one of the reasons I brought you on is that you do talk golf on the show. You're a big golf guy. And golf has been really big, especially this past weekend with the PGA Championship happening. And, of course, the big story is Tiger Woods finishing in second place. But before we get into Tiger, I want to get into the guy who won the PGA Championship. He's also won another major this year, and Brooks Capel. Am I saying his name correctly?
That's Koepka. Brooks Koepka.
Koepka. Okay, Brooks Koepka.
Yep.
How good is Brooks Koepka? It looks like this guy is an absolute beast.
So he won back-to-back U.S. Open, which is pretty unheard of. I don't know the stat right off the top of my head. I read it the other day, and I wish I would have wrote it down. But there's not very many guys that have won back-to-back U.S. Opens, and this guy did it. There's only been three or four guys that have won the U.S. Open and the PGA Championship in the same year. Tiger Woods is one. I think Jack Nicklaus was another. Sorensen, and then there's one other guy that did it. Maybe it was like Nick Faldo, the guy that commentates the PGA Tour. But there's only been like four other guys that have done it besides this guy, and he is literally phenomenal when it comes to major championships. There's something about this guy, the way that he gets dialed in and he plays a certain way during majors, it is pretty neat to watch. He needs to tighten it up a little bit on the other tournaments that he plays in throughout the year, but long hitter. I mean, he hits his driver 340 yards in the air, straight as an arrow. He hits a little bit of maybe a little bit of a fade, a little bit of a draw. He can kind of work it both ways. But the thing about this kid, yeah, he hits it a long ways, but around the greens, he is phenomenal. There was one hole, I think it was the 16th hole, where he hit a drive. It was wayward. It went behind a tree. He needed a drop, so he took a stroke, had to drop, hit the ball left of the green, off the side into some thick stuff. You're thinking, oh man, he's going to double bogey, and then it was a 40-yard chip, and he hit it within like maybe a foot, a tap in bogey, where he could have lost two shots and he only lost one. This is the type of thing that he can do on a regular basis, and I think goes a little bit unheard, or you don't talk about as much with this guy because he just hits the ball so far. But his short game is second to none, especially in the majors.
Wow. So is there any resemblance of his game compared to a younger Tiger?
For sure. And a couple different ways. One, he hits the ball a lot farther than everyone else, but it's more about his mentality than it is probably about his game. Because, back in the day when Tiger was making his run like he did on Sunday, shooting a 64, other guys in the field would have crumbled. And this guy relished in it. I mean, he literally, I think he might even mention something after the tournament. It was kind of fun to be out there. I heard roars out in front of me. I knew Tiger was probably doing some big things, making some birdies. And I just kind of got a smile on my face, thinking, man, he's doing his thing. This is fun. I can't believe that I'm up against Tiger. And, he didn't let any of that faze him, which, a lot of guys under that type of pressure would fold. And he played probably even better when he knew Tiger was out there shooting a low number. I think it was hole 15, no, 17. 15 or 17 is one of those. It's the longer par 3. It's like 248-yard par 3. And he just hit a stripe. I mean, he hit it right at the pin. His caddy said something to the effect of, right when it left his golf club, it was on target at the pin the whole way. And I think it went within maybe 2 or 3 feet. And he, obviously made the birdie putt. Ended up being, instead of a one-stroke lead, a two-stroke lead with like two holes to play. And, he basically just shut the door on a 248-yard par 3. I mean, that's, us amateurs, we probably couldn't even hit the green if we tried in 10 or 12 shots. And this guy just in a major pressure, only up by one, Tiger on his heels, and he strikes one and lands it within 3 feet and makes the putt. I mean, that's, the type of guy that he is. He loves the pressure. He thrives in it. And that's what kind of reminds me of Tiger Woods. Back to your question. I kind of rambled there.
No problem, man. I love the knowledge that you're dropping right now. And speaking of Tiger Woods, I saw that it was a crazy jump in the ratings when people realized that Tiger had a chance on Sunday. Like, it was
69%.
How would I say that one more time?
69% jump in ratings. 69%. That's over half. I mean, that's like an astronomical number. I mean, a crazy number.
So why do you think Tiger is so important to golf? And even after all these years of not winning majors, going through his personal things, having all the back surgeries, why do you think Tiger is still such a big draw?
Human nature, man. We love the comeback story. We love the underdog. I mean, when Tiger was really good back in the day, I wasn't a huge fan because I was a fan of golf, and I felt like there was too much coverage with Tiger. You saw him. He might be like way back in the pack, but you saw every shot that he took, and you weren't watching, you know, a lot of the guys that were at the top of the leaderboard. So, you know, for me to say this is kind of an interesting topic. But, you know, the underdog story, the comeback, that's always cool to see. Human nature, we like to see those things. But I think what it is about Tiger is, you know, when I was growing up watching golf in high school, I didn't even pick up the game. I didn't even care about it at the time. You know, I was a basketball, baseball player. I didn't really care about golf. But when Tiger came on the scene, you know, we had all these guys out there on tour. I just thought they were a bunch of old guys wearing, you know, business casual clothes. I'm like, what are all these frumpy dudes doing swinging a golf club? This looks ridiculous. But then Tiger comes along, right? And he's charismatic. Brings, you know, a certain type of flair that you didn't see in golf. You know, the fist pumps, the PGA Championship, where, you know, it's like a 30-foot putt, and it was about halfway there, and he starts pointing at the hole, and he walks it in. I mean, it's one of the most infamous, you know, golf coverage shots that you'll see in probably the last 100 years, right? So, you know, just that charisma and flash and flair that he brought to the game that we hadn't seen, I think it drew a lot of people that, you know, weren't fans of the game, and they kind of yearn for that a little bit, and they want that more in the game, because it can be a fun, you know, fist pump, you know, celebratory type of game, but it just, you know, in years past it hasn't been that. And I think with him doing that and then going away for a little bit, I think people really want to see that again.
Yeah, it's phenomenal how just seeing how he brings everybody to the game. I was at a sports bar because I was covering the Mercury game that I think started like right after the tournament ended. So I was at a sports bar right by the arena just eating right before I went into the Mercury game and watching everybody just so captivated by what was going on in the tournament. And I saw one shot that he hit that was a phenomenal shot that landed just a few feet before the hole. And I think anybody in the world would be happy with that shot. But he was upset that he didn't get an eagle. That really shows you. It really shows you how far he's come from, you know, pre-back surgery to now in his game. And with his game now, how different is it from when he was dominating? Like, how many changes has he had to make to be successful now versus when he was dominating the world?
Yeah, so he's made, I want to say, and don't quote me on this verbatim, but yeah, it was at least two or three swing changes that he's made since, you know, he dominated. He came out, he just kind of used the natural swing that his dad kind of taught him, and then he switched it. He won a bunch of tournaments, he switched it again. It took him a few months or maybe a year to get back, but then he won a bunch of tournaments and majors after that. I think he's done, you know, maybe two or three swing changes since then, but the swing that he has now is more conducive to less injuries. Okay. So, you know, if you want to sit down and kind of break down a swing, you know, on every pixel, you know, in the backswing and through the follow through, you can definitely tell there's, you know, it's more ergonomically correct, and it's not putting as much torque on his lower body as he used to. And, you know, I think that was something that he really had to focus on for a really long time. I think that's why it's taken him so long to get back to this point. but his hand-eye coordination and his mental toughness and the way that he can kind of maneuver around the greens didn't really change much. So just getting back into a rhythm, you know, getting that feel around the greens, like he's going to be able to, I think he's going to be able to win more majors. I don't know if he's going to get to Jack's mark at 18, just based on where he's at age-wise right now, and then just all the other great golfers that are in the mix right now, the young golfers, that I don't know if he can get to 18, but he'll definitely, in my opinion, I think he's going to win at least two more. I think he has that type of game.
Wow. Right, and that's crazy because seems like a few months ago the debate was, will he ever contend in a major again? And now we're at the point of we think he could win one, maybe two more majors. It's a crazy turnaround that we've seen Tiger make. But you mentioned those young players that are coming up or that may have already arrived. Who are the, for the people who are the casual golf fans, who are the other golfers out there outside of Brooks and Tiger that we should be looking out for?
Yeah, I mean, there's some bigger names out there. I mean, there's Justin Thomas, Dustin Johnson, Phil Mickelson. He's a little bit older. He kind of came up with the Tiger, but he's a fun one to watch. He doesn't contend as much as he should, but, you know, Phil Lefty, he's a good one. He's one of my favorite golfers anyway. Ricky Fowler, he's another one that, you know, a lot of people probably know. He's really flashy. Wears the orange because he went to Oklahoma State. But there's one kid that I really do want to talk about, and his name is Thomas Peters. He's from Belgium. I think he tied sixth at the PGA Championship this past weekend. But this kid, he has a lot of the same game as Brooks Koepka. He's only 26. I think Brooks Koepka is maybe 28. I put that into perspective too. But, you know, Thomas Peters, 26. He's from Belgium. He played at Illinois. He won the 2012 NCAA championship. He won maybe two championships with Illinois, like team championships with Illinois. He has three professional victories. He tied for fourth at the 2017 Masters. And then if you watch the 2016 Ryder Cup, that was kind of his, you know, coming out party. I mean, he was the only one that basically scored any points on the American team on the Europe side. So, you know, he's got a really solid game from tee to green, hits the ball a long ways. As long as he can keep his putter under control, you know, he gets, you know, 26 to, you know, 30 putts around, he's going to be pretty consistent from, you know, hole 1 to hole 18. But, you know, that's probably one of his little hiccups, but mentally tough, hits the ball a long way, great iron player, and, you know, he's a lot of fun to watch. And he does kind of have a little bit of that charismatic flair to him. He's probably not quite like Tiger, but he definitely has, what do I want to say here? He definitely has a little skip in his giddy-up, you know what I mean? Like, when he walks around the golf course, like, he kind of has a chip on his shoulder, and you can kind of tell. Like he thinks he's good, you know what I mean? Like, so that's kind of fun to watch.
Okay. Now, just to bring it back to Tiger just one second, you mentioned how the young golfer has that skip in him where you can see he has a little swag on the course. Tiger has that. Do you think that confidence, that swagger, has become more accepted? I know that one time it was a point where it wasn't accepted. It was kind of frowned upon to have that. It was frowned upon to show emotion. I know at one point when Tiger would get upset and swing his golf club, it was something that was a big news in the golf world where he would get upset. Has that been more accepted to show emotion while playing golf?
Okay. The crazy thing about this is there's two sides to this story, because a lot of the traditional older golfers are probably on the side of, yeah, you shouldn't show emotion, you should go about your business and just do your thing. And yeah, I kind of get where they're coming from. That is the traditional golf. But if you look at golf as a whole, people aren't playing as much, it's too expensive, everybody thinks it's all hoity-toity, you know, whatever the case, however, whatever stereotype you want to label it, the fact of the matter is that if country clubs and golf courses and people that are in the industry, they need flashy. They need emotion. They need those types of things to get people to watch the game, fall in love with the game, and want to go out on the evenings and weekends and play the game. So for me, as a big, huge golf fan, I want to see it keep thriving and growing and making it to that next level. We need guys in the game that are going to bring eyes to the television. And one of the ways that you can do that in a game that can be slow and can be a little bit mundane is you got to show a little bit of emotion. You got to show the fact that, hey, even if it was a par putt, it was a 30-foot par putt, don't just, you know, tip your cap and say, oh, you know, thank you, you know, oh, yeah, fist pump, you know, walk it in, do a little shimmy shake. I don't give a shit, but, you know, make it fun, make it exciting. I think it would be cool.
Definitely show emotion. I think golf and baseball have that in common where it's frowned upon to show emotion, and I don't understand why. Like, in baseball, if I get a home run, I get a walk-off, I should be able to celebrate. Like, that's a big moment right there. I shouldn't, if I flip my bat, so what? You shouldn't have gave up the home run. In golf, if you're, we all know how tough golf is. Like, we've all tried our hand at golf. And so it's not something that you can naturally be good at. So when you put that much work into a sport, it's not like, you know, somebody who, like Odell Beckham, just a natural athlete. He was going to be good at any sport he tried, right? You know, but golf is something that you have to be skilled at. And when you put that much work into something, you should be allowed to celebrate when you do well. It's not like it's a lucky thing. Like, you put in hours upon hours upon hours of work, you should be able to celebrate. So I definitely agree with you there that if there was more emotion showed, I think it would bring more people to the screen. And Tiger's not going to be around forever. So you need someone else who's going to bring that attention to golf. So I definitely agree with you there. And let me get you on this last question before I get you out.
Okay.
You mentioned Phil Mickelson as one of your favorites. Who else is one of your favorite golfers and why?
Yeah, here's the cool thing. And here's where I'll kind of put in a little bit of a pitch here about why you should be watching golf. Because I have several golfers that I like, and there's several different reasons why. And if you've ever picked up a club and you've played the game, there is one aspect of the game that you really enjoy or that you're good at. Some people can drive the ball really straight, or they can hit it really far, or they hit their irons really good, or they're a really good putter, or you're really good about chipping around the green. If you've ever played the game, there's something that you can latch on to that you love and that you feel like you're good at when it comes to the game of golf. So there's a ton of golfers out on the PGA Tour, right? And all of them are relatively good at any aspect of those. So if you're a long hitter and you hit the ball straight and you're a fan of that, then you go out and watch Brooks Koepka. You watch Dustin Johnson. You watch Bubba Watson, who hits it a ton. You know, there's guys out there. Those are probably my three favorite long ball hitters out on the tour right now. And they do a great job of just on, especially now where you get to watch like the shot tracker and you get to see the, you know, how high and how far they hit it. It's really neat to watch. If you're really good with your iron play, then Justin Rose is a good one. Justin Thomas is another one. Sergio Garcia is a really good iron player. So you could relate to those guys. If you're looking at chipping around the green, Jordan Spieth, he's really good around the greens and making sure to, you know, shoot a good score and not, you know, put up the huge numbers. So if you scramble around the greens, you're really good. Jordan Spieth is one of those guys that you can watch around the green. Lefty, Phil Mickelson, he's a lizard when it comes to the types of things that he can do around the greens. Tiger Woods is another guy. If you watch him out of the bunker, you know, around the side of the greens, he's another one of those guys that's just a wizard in that area. And then putting, I mean, there's a ton of guys out there on tour that are really good putters. Jordan Spieth, you got to go back to him. You know, week in, week out, he's probably one of the better putters on tour. So he's another one to watch out for. Justin Rose, he's usually pretty good with the flat stick. But you know, those are some guys that I really like and I really enjoy watching. And it just depends on what you can relate to. There's so many things that you can relate to on the golf course and watching these guys. And you know, that's kind of my little two cents on why you should be watching the PGA Tour, maybe.
Yeah, no, it definitely makes me want to watch when you break it down that way, because it's always, like for me with boxing, I have boxers that I like because of different reasons. And I think you can relate to that with golf. You have the different golfers that have different skill sets that you can relate to and like. So I really appreciate you coming on, man. And before I let you go, where can people find you and follow you, and where can they find the show?
Yeah, so on Facebook, I Need a Mulligan podcast. So check it out there. On Twitter, I don't have a Twitter handle for the podcast. It's just my Twitter handle, which is TKC Goldsmith on Twitter. And then I got a new show that'll be coming out this weekend. I have Nick Murphy. He's a podcast host of a podcast called the Job Lab podcast, entrepreneur here in the Omaha area. But he was an ASU Sun Devil. And he played in the NFL, and he played with a lot of the guys that had Hall of Fame speeches. So we're going to have a pretty cool conversation come this Friday. So you guys want to check that out this weekend.
Oh, definitely. I can't wait for that one to come out. Very excited for it. Thank you again for coming on. We're going to take a quick break, play a little music that you can jam to. And when we come back, we're going to talk about Carmelo Anthony. Will he help or will he hurt the Houston Rockets? We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you're enjoying the show. Thank you to TK Goldsmith for coming on and spitting some knowledge about golf and Tiger Woods. Definitely appreciate that. So now we're going to get into Carmelo Anthony joining the Houston Rockets. It's been a rumor for quite a while that he's going to join Houston back when he was still with OKC. They had to trade him and Atlanta had to buy him out. A lot of things had to happen, but it's finally official. Carmelo Anthony is a Houston Rocket. Now, are the Houston Rockets just as good as last year? Better than last year? Or maybe even worse than they were last year? Now, last year, you think about this team. They were the number one seed in the Western Conference. Made it to the Western Conference Finals. And I still believe if Chris Paul was healthy, they would have beaten the Golden State Warriors, went to the Finals, and then beat Cleveland. It would have been a better series. I think Cleveland would have been a better matchup against Houston than Golden State. But still have Houston winning that series if they're healthy going in. But this offseason, they lost Trevor Ariza to the Suns. He went signed for 1 year and $15 million. They also lost Luke Mahamute. I forgot if he has signed anywhere yet, but he's gone. And we didn't see him at his best last year, especially towards the end because he had so many shoulder problems. But he's very important as well to that team because of his defensive abilities to be able to switch and defend at a high level. So you lose those two guys and pretty much replace them with Carmelo Anthony. Now, of course, Carmelo is a better offensive player, even at this point of his career, than both of those guys. He's going to be able to provide you that offensive option that those guys cannot. He still can isolate, give him the ball in the mid-post. He still can do work. Maybe just not at the level that he once could. You think about last year, he had the worst year of his career by far. You know, even when he was a rookie, he was out there getting 20 points a game. Last year, he only averaged 16, 5.8 rebounds on 40% shooting, 35% from three. Now, the 35% from three, that's pretty much what he averages for his career. So that's not outside of the norm. What's outside of the norm is the 40% from the field and only getting 16 points per game. But we had to expect his production to go down because it's the first time in his career where he was no longer the number one option. You know, outside, of course, of All-Star games and the Olympics. The first time where he was on a team where he was no longer the number one option. And how do you adjust to that? And he's been doing it for so long. Outside of the NBA, he's been the number one option on his team since probably 5 years old. I think that's one thing that when people say, oh, he was selfish, he didn't want to come off the bench, that's a hard adjustment to make. You think about you being the number one guy your whole life. 30 some odd years, you're the dude. And then all that changes. You have to adjust. And I think he did a good job of trying to adjust. I think just in the offense, he never got a chance to get in rhythm. So I do think he will have a more efficient year in Houston because he will have more of a chance to get in rhythm. There will be times where James Harden is going to get hot. He might not touch the ball for a while. But there's going to be more opportunities with a player like a Chris Paul where he's going to get the ball right in the right spot. Have to take, you know, open shots. He had open shots in OKC, don't get me wrong. You know, Russell Westbrook is great. Paul George is also an awesome player. But they're not the floor generals that Chris Paul and James Harden are. So I think that Carmelo Anthony will be better next season with the Rockets. But the Rockets themselves will be worse. And it's not Carmelo's fault, though. Carmelo didn't do or will not do anything wrong or nothing that is outside of what we expect him to do. I think he's going to average around the same amount, probably like 16 points a game, just more efficient. He's going to have more threes, of course, in Houston's system. That's what they want him to do. And I think he's going to be more efficient when he gets those isolation opportunities. There have been rumors that he might be coming off the bench for them, which I think would be awesome because he can go out there and destroy a second unit. He may have times where he may be Chris Paul and James Harden are both sitting, and he's the guy leading the offense. I think it's a good situation for Carmelo individually, but as a team, they won't be as good, which makes me sad because now it makes an even easier road for the stacked Golden State Warriors. You think about the Golden State Warriors, if Boogie comes back healthy, that's a big if. We know an Achilles injury is no joke. It's nothing to sneeze at when you're trying to come back from that. If he comes back healthy, let's say he's at 80-90% of what he was, who can beat them? Honestly, if he's back to being anywhere near what he was, who can touch them? We know no one can touch them. And Houston has taken a step back. The Lakers will be interesting. But when LeBron has to depend on Kyle Kuzma and Lonzo Ball and Brandon Ingram against the Warriors or against the Rockets or against the Pelicans, these teams that have been through the playoff wars these past few years, you really think those young boys ready? So the Lakers will be interesting. They will make the playoffs, of course, but they're not a true contender. So with the Carmelo Anthony signing, it just, for me, it just says, the West is going to be good, but of course Golden State is on a tear by themselves. And hopefully Boston, Toronto from the Eastern Conference can challenge them, because I don't think they'll have a true challenger in the West. They won't walk through the Western Conference, but it won't be as hard as it was last year. I don't see Houston pushing them to 7 games or anyone in the Western Conference pushing them again. They'll have to wait until the finals. But of course, I think Boston has a perfect team going into next year to really push the Golden State Warriors. But I am happy for Carmelo. I think he will have a better year as an individual, but it won't lead to team success. So now we're going to take a quick commercial break, or music break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about Bruce Bowen not getting renewed because he criticized the player. Like, that doesn't happen all the time. But we'll get into it, and I'll tell you my thoughts.
Oh, man. And with the local DBC news, LL Cool J with a triumphant comeback. Morris. But tonight,
don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my pants. Put suckers in fear. Making the tears rain down like a monsoon. Listen to the bass go boom. Explosion.
Knock you out.
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Now let's get into the Bruce Bowen, Kawhi Leonard situation. So we all know the drama that went down with Kawhi Leonard this year. He didn't believe that the Spurs treated him correctly as far as his injuries were concerned. He was not happy there. Eventually, he got traded off to Toronto. And during the year, of course, there was a lot of talk about the situation. Bruce Bowen, who was the color analyst for the Los Angeles Clippers, and of course is a Spur legend, if you will. Of course, he had his opinion about the situation, and his opinion lost him his job. Yes, so he didn't get fired, technically, as I'm putting up air quotes, you can't see that. But he didn't get fired, but his contract did not get renewed. And they stated that it was because of his inflammatory comments about Kawhi Leonard. So before I get into what I truly think about what happened, let's listen to the hot fire that Bruce Bowen was out here spitting.
I mean, this is what I tell people in San Antonio when they say, Bruce, what's going on? I said, what has been going on? Have you heard Kawhi say anything? No. I say it's the equivalent for guys when we give that young lady our number and she never calls us. And we're wondering, is she interested? I think it's been said. Not one time has Kawhi come out and said anything to the effect of, you know what, hey, I really enjoyed being in San Antonio, or I can't stand what's going on here in San Antonio. Not one time has he said anything.
So with all this going on, why wouldn't he say something now?
Well, I think he's getting bad advice. I think what you're starting to see now is, you know, an individual given a certain amount of advice, and it's not the right advice. Here it is. You were protected in San Antonio. I think there's nothing but excuses going on. Mm-hmm. So first it was, well, I was misdiagnosed. Look here. You got $18 million this year. And you think that they're trying to rush you? You didn't play, for the most part, a full season this year. And you're the go-to guy. You're the franchise. And you want to say that they didn't have your best interest at heart? Are you kidding me?
So that was what Bruce Bowen had to say about the Kawhi Leonard situation. And what did he say that was out of pocket or out of line? He gave his opinion, and that's what people like him, me, Stephen A., all those guys do. And I'm not trying to put myself in those categories as far as the level they're on, but I do believe I'm just as good as those guys, right? So when I talk about giving my opinion, and if I'm with, right now I'm with a 3-point conversion, right? And we're building a company, one day we're going to be really big. The one thing that's going to keep us true is the fact that we're going to be able to give our opinions without fear of losing our job because, oh, you said something about Kevin Durant and now he doesn't want to do an interview. That could happen. Right, because I've been very critical of Kevin Durant and DeMarcus Cousins for their decisions to join Golden State. So hopefully I never get in a position where they're like, well, you said these things that the players didn't agree with, so we have to get rid of you so we can get an interview with them. Or if I'm working for a certain team, if the player is like, well, I can't go there because this guy is there and he said this or that. If I didn't say anything truly out of bounds, like if I don't say anything about your family or something, just something crazy, disrespectful, if I'm keeping it within the realm of sports, just because you disagree with what I said doesn't mean that the organization should be like, well, we have to make sure we have everything perfect for this guy. That's going to lead just, it leaves me dumbfounded because it's, what are you going to do as an analyst? Just say, everyone's great? That's the problem with the local announced teams anyway. If you have NBA League Pass, you know what I'm talking about. Everything is homer this and homer that. Oh, we're not getting the calls, or there's never any criticism of the players that's on the court that's playing for the team that they announced for. And now I see why. I thought it was just, oh, that team, they get so used to being around the team, they become fans of them. And I understand that. You know, covering the Phoenix Mercury, it's hard not to cheer for that team because you start to know the players. You're like, oh, man, these, you know, they're cool people. And you start to get a little invested. You're like, oh, I want them to win. And you become somewhat of a fan of these players. So I understand that aspect of it, but you still have to be objective. And Bruce Bowen, I believe, was the perfect color analyst for the Clippers because he's a Spurs guy. So he's not going to be biased for the Clippers. He's going to give you honest analysis, be objective while he's calling the game. And that could uplift the whole stigma of the local announcer. Because anybody who has NBA League Pass knows what I'm talking about. It can get disgusting at times. You just, oh my God, I can't even listen to these guys call the game because they're just not objective at all. So now you get rid of Bruce Bowen. You're going to bring in someone who's going to be a homer, obviously, who's going to make sure he kisses up to Kawhi Leonard whenever he's a free agent. And understand you're trying to get Kawhi. He's a top three player in this league. But if Kawhi doesn't want to come there just because Bruce Bowen said those things, he's not going to come there anyway. Like, if that's going to be the factor that keeps him from being there, he didn't want to come in the first place. So I feel bad for Bruce. I feel like he did a good job as a color analyst. In that interview, he was just giving his honest opinion. Even though he's a Spurs homer, what he said wasn't out of pocket at all. And as a podcaster or a reporter or an analyst, if we can't be honest, then let's just get everybody who's going to come and kiss up to the players and just say, you're perfect. You're wonderful. You're a unicorn over a rainbow. Just all the nice things they want to hear, because at this point, if you're going to fire him or not fire him, not renew his contract for that, what can any... The next person that comes in has no choice but to come in and be hesitant about any opinion they have. It's just... Stories like that make me mad, because it's something that I'm lucky that I have my podcast I can do. I can say whatever I want to say. Because if you're under the thumb of someone else and they're not renewing your contract just because you gave your honest opinion, where is the world going when it comes to sports media? Do apologize for the silence, but it just made me upset. I want to thank you guys for listening to today's episode of The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Thank you again to TK Goldsmith for coming through and spitting that hot knowledge, spitting hot lava when it came to golf. Really appreciate that. So I want to thank you guys again for listening. If you enjoyed the episode, please share it with your friends, family, people you don't like, everybody. Share it, all right? And make sure you follow me on social media at The Real Deal WDA. That's The Real Deal, W as in whiskey, D as in Delta, A as in apple. On social media everywhere. And subscribe to The Real Deal with Damian Adams on Apple Podcasts, on Spreaker Radio, on a 3-Point Conversion station. And make sure you follow 3-Point Conversion as well, all right? And until next time, go real or go home. And of course, on the next episode, we will be coming back with sports trivia, forgotten players, all the good stuff that you like. Until next time, peace.